broadcasting to you live from the Milky Way galaxy, the solar system, planet Earth, North America, the United States of America, California, Los Angeles, to be very specific. Hello, everybody. Welcome. My name is Brian Engelman. You are here at the TNAM radio network at thenewamericanmedia.com. And you have found us on Agree to Disagree. This is a show where we talk about anything. Yeah, we tend to just kind of focus on politics because that's one way to look at it. My guest tonight has a little bit of a different way to look at things. Cosmic mythologist and great-granddaughter of President Dwight David Eisenhower, Laura Eisenhower will be our guest for the program. And we're going to talk about a whole bunch of interesting stuff. Are you ready for this? Exopolitics, alchemy, metaphysics? Yeah! Do we ever have a meeting with our elected officials and presidents, with other entities in the universe? I'm sorry, but if you refuse to acknowledge that as a possibility, you're really not studying the subject, and we hope to have a conversation tonight that's going to get you thinking about these things, perhaps in a different way than you usually do. Either tomorrow or the next day, we're going to bring in former NBA scout, current NBA consultant Zach Barris for the Unhappy Hour. That's our sports radio program. And we got to talk about Kyrie Irving's season high, NBA season high, 57-point performance. Just hitting clutch shot after clutch shot yesterday to beat the Spurs in San Antonio at the buzzer. 57 points. He set a career high. It's an NBA season high. I don't know. Has Kyrie played himself into a MVP candidate dark horse? Everyone wants to talk about LeBron, but hey, Kyrie, man, having a hell of a season for those Cavaliers, and they're looking pretty darn unbeatable. At least as scary as any other team in the NBA. So I'm really looking forward as a Cleveland sports fan to check that out. But we cover Indians, Cavs, Browns, and Buckeyes stuff. That's why it's called the Unhappy Hour. Check it out there. If you're listening to this after the fact on YouTube, thank you very much. Please click subscribe. That would be youtube.com/thenewamericanmedia. Click subscribe. And if those ads are playing, you know, before or after the video, or there's an overlay with a box, if you guys leave those things on there and click on them, we have just monetized our website for the first time in almost 4 years. We're going to be 4 years old in about a month and a half or so. And we've never really found ways of revenue. But you know, it ain't easy taking all the time that this takes to prepare for shows, to go to events and meet people like Laura Eisenhower, to go out and film stuff, to ask people like Ted Distel of distaldesign.com, go visit his site. Working with Adidas now and doing a lot of stuff. He does great visual and computer work, but you know, you gotta kind of entice their time as well. It's like you gotta kick them a few bucks to, you know, it just when you start adding this up, it takes a little bit of money to fund the project, and we haven't really gone there yet. But anyway, the point is, just leave those ads on or click on them and check out what, you know, watch the 30-second video, and we actually make a couple pennies off of that. And, you know, over tens of thousands of views and hundreds of thousands of views, you know, it really takes a little bit of the edge off of all of the expenses and finances involved with maintaining a project thus, like the one you are hearing here. Because I really like doing this, and I want to do more of this, you know? So we're gonna find a way to do this together, because really, the New American Media is you. It's you with your camera, it's you with your cell phone, it's you. You know, if you're over there in Ferguson, are you witness to something? Can you gather information? You are the New American Media. Anybody can break a story on Twitter. It's global. Instantly. Use it for good. You know? Hate seeing what's going on in Ferguson. Just hate it. I really just want to negotiate ceasefires at this point. Whether it's Israel and Gaza, whether it's ISIS, whether it's Al-Qaeda, the United States military-industrial complex, of which Laura Eisenhower has a little bit of experience. you're going to love these stories. So, anyway, you're the New American Media, but you got to connect with us on all of our places. So, like I said, subscribe on YouTube. On Twitter, we're at American_media_. That's American_media_. On Facebook, do a search for thenewamericanmedia.com and like the page. You can also do the Facebook and the Twitter on our homepage, thenewamericanmedia.com. On the right-hand side, that's our TNAM radio button. That's where you click play to listen to this show live when we're broadcasting. And then on the right side as well, that's you can click on Twitter and Facebook right from there. But first, let me tell you a little bit about Laura. Laura Eisenhower is a global alchemist, a cosmic mythologist, and an intuitive astrologist. She's an internationally acclaimed speaker who's presented her work worldwide and the great-granddaughter of President Dwight David Eisenhower. She's considered by many to be one of North America's leading researchers on health, exopolitics, alchemy, metaphysics, and ancient history. So let's bring her into the show right about now. Laura, welcome to the program. How are you doing today?
I'm great. How are you doing?
Living the dream. Fantastic. Thanks for joining us again. I know we had a chance to talk back in 2012 at the Conscious Life Expo then, and it's been quite a few years since we've had a chance to talk again, so welcome to the program. I'm happy to have you here on Agree to Disagree.
I'm so glad to be here. Thank you so much for having me.
Oh, sure thing. I was reading a little bit of your intro, health, exopolitics, alchemy, metaphysics, ancient history. There are so many different angles and different topics we can cover here. I think I just want to start at the beginning. Laura Eisenhower wakes up, whatever age that is, and when you start becoming aware of what's going on and knowing that your great-grandfather ran this country for a while, and some consider him to be the last real president this country has had, can you start from the beginning and kind of introduce us to you, how you were growing up and how you got brought into the world, kind of peeling back the layers of the onion the way that you have been?
Sure. Gosh. Well, it was very different for me, my sisters, and my cousins compared to my mom and her siblings. I mean, they had Secret Service men follow them to school. You know, their grandfather was, you know, in office when they were, you know, teenagers. And with us, you know, we were just kind of, okay, not a whole lot of people knew I was even connected. I didn't carry this last name. My name got legally changed because basically my mom raised me, and she's like, you know what, you know, I don't know why people take the man's last name, you know, kind of attitude. And anyway, my name was legally changed to have Eisenhower in it because obviously, you know, my mom's the Eisenhower, and we usually take the father's name. And so that was sort of along the way. But I guess just to kind of back up, I always have been processing from the time I was really young, you know, trying to figure everything out as far as the madness on this planet. I mean, obviously it took different forms and went through different stages. When I was, you know, much younger, it was just the recognition of, like, Magdalene and Christ and Ike, who was just, like, always around me, like his spirit. And being, like, a very clairvoyant and very open child, you know, I was just like, what's going on here? And I shared a room with my sister. I'm like, Caroline, are you seeing this? Like, what is going on? I might have had a really high fever some of those days, too. But the whole point is, you know, something was starting to enter my awareness. And, of course, as you get older, the mind starts to develop and, you know, one has the capacity to research and read. And what really, you know, brought it over the edge of taking it into a direction that my family doesn't talk about and isn't anything that you can find any quotes on when it comes to family was when I saw a weekly world news article, which is usually, like, completely fake. You know, Bat Boy takes over New York City.
Right, right.
You know, I'm standing there in the checkout line, and, you know, it says Eisenhower met with ETs. And I'm, you know, older at this point, maybe 11. And I'm like, you know what? That's a true story. I just knew it. And I had some interesting encounters and interesting dreams that were kind of preparing me for my mission and things related to the window period that we're in right now. And, you know, I was looking through viewfinders and seeing timelines. I was connecting with, you know, what it means when the natural stargates open and how it relates to our DNA. And I couldn't really make sense out of it. It was just sort of like I was living this double life. I did terrible in school. I was very rebellious. I was always daydreaming. I was like the worst student. So, and then you get to a certain point where you question yourself, like, God, maybe I do have learning disability, you know. Then I'm like, no. Like, you know, obviously your mind is on all this stuff. I'm like, yeah, but nobody wants to talk about this. Like,
did they give you the ADD, the Ritalin and that type of stuff?
Well, they did test me for something. I refused all, you know, drugs. And I had an alcohol issue, so I just picked and choose, I guess, what substances I was going to do. But that was my high school, and I felt like I was living a double life, and I just couldn't talk about this stuff. And I went through a lot of, you know, I guess you could say dark night of the soul journeys, one that seemed to just be never-ending, that seemed to last like 2 decades. And most of my life was really about the energy, you know, and just, you know, trying to find balance, you know, seeing, you know, the matrix and all the programming and not feeling like, you know, I could resonate at all or connect with that world, and trying to find just, I guess, some peace of mind. So I went into wilderness expedition leadership and just hit the mountains and hung out in the wilderness for years just to get over D.C. and all this other stuff that I had been exposed to. And it was obvious I wasn't being groomed to be a politician, or if anybody was trying, it wasn't going to happen.
It but wasn't taking. With,
yeah, but I was definitely going to, you know, be, you know, taking on a role in, you know, a mission that has to do with the planet and, you know, very important things, just coming at it from a different angle. I've always been close to the spirit of Ike. I've always been close to my grandfather, his son, and he always, like, really admired my character. I turned things down that were really about, you know, the Eisenhower name and just sort of some of the benefits that come along with it, like, you know, some, you know, big gatherings. Like, I was supposed to represent the United States in the International Ball in New York City, which is a huge deal, and I just thought, I can't do it. And my grandfather was like, you know what, you're a real warrior. You're really on this path. I really admire the fact that, you know, you're bold and you're willing to, you know, break tradition. And it's not like you're not doing something. He completely got, like, I've been wrapped up in this mission. So a lot of it had to do with sort of the mythologies and, like, getting a grip on the balancing of the masculine and feminine. Then we're dealing with the exopolitical. And then the recruitment I went through in 2006. And that, like, helped me to lift the lid and really understand the shadow government stuff, even though I'd already, you know, had a bit of an inkling. And I've just been trying to connect the dots ever since. I'm close to my family. I've always, like, made them wonder and scratch their head. My sisters are great. I'm in the middle child, and we get closer and closer all the time. And there was a little bit of a downtime where everybody was a little bit worried, you know, what I was saying, what I was putting out there. And I think, you know, they're just grateful that somebody's willing to cover this topic. It's always sort of eluded them. And, I mean, even my mom told me, she goes, I had to write to, you know, my dad, you know, my grandfather, not Ike, but Ike's son, about all these rumors about Ike and ETs. And, you know, my grandfather just said that he did go to that dentist appointment. I'm like, no, I mean, somebody's trying to protect somebody here. And we're not a family of, I mean, it's high integrity. And, you know, there's reasons for certain things that we don't quite understand. But, you know, Ike had 8 heart attacks and people were being killed for sharing this sort of stuff. And so I'm like, okay, I'm born into this and the timing seems to be right. I've got a big mouth. I'm rebellious. I don't fear death. Let's get things going here. And my whole life has sort of been about that, while maybe rebellious is the wrong word, but really wanting to push the envelope and break open, you know, this shell that we were born into so that we can really function on an organic level and assist this ascension process. Because really, you know, our DNA is connected to the stargates, and this window period is all about the expansion and the opening up into all this. And that is what has always been the most dominant thing I've understood. Everything else is like, okay, researching, listening to whistleblowers, understanding the game that's being played and what the origins are and all the galactic wars. Some things, you know, resonate deeply, like I was, you know, there or a part of it. And some things, you know, I'm incorporating into it and, you know, wondering what should stay and what should go, because it's like archaeology. But the one thing I do is just encourage people to have an open mind and to take what resonates and leave the rest. I'm certainly not here to create, you know, fixed beliefs. But I've really enjoyed, you know, growing up in this family in a lot of ways. Some of it, you know, was very difficult. I mean, there was no trust fund, you know, there was no cushiness that, or extra special thing that I had that, you know, one would say, okay, well, that's what a presidential family gets. It's like, it was very normal, and actually, it was a lot of struggle, too. You know, going through 2 divorces, actually, and a 3rd one later on, that was fine. Moving around a lot, not having a mom home, you know, that often, and, you know, just trying to manage the mission. I mean, that was all, you know, I could really understand. And, you know, people have a lot of projections. Oh, I must be sitting on all this money. It's like, I've raised, you know, 2 boys. They're 16 now. And, you know, had to do the food stamp thing, you know, did every job under the sun, because it's not like I could go out in the wilderness and, you know, go anywhere. And that was great, because, you know, it brought me into, you know, doing what I'm doing now and doing readings and sessions, which, you know, this is my ultimate passion. I think the wilderness stuff is just to give me that basic, you know, just to give me that experience so that I would know that I do have the will to survive. I do know how to survive. I do know how to lead. I do know how to harmonize groups. And so all the projections that I'm crazy, that I've got ADD, and that I'm a terrible student and I'm stupid started to float away and started to leave my space. I'm still recovering, but, you know, I'm definitely more solid than ever.
Tell me a little bit. I like to do this in the beginning part so people, once they're interested, tell us about the readings that you're doing, and let's get this out of the way. Tell everybody about, you know, where they can connect with you. I know Facebook is a big medium, a nice place where I see you posting a lot now and connecting with a lot of your fans. So, yeah, if you could just maybe take a second and tell people what you're doing with the readings and how they can stay in touch with what the latest is with Laura Eisenhower. Let's do that if we can.
Oh, that's great. I've been doing tarot and astrology for more than 20 years, just for myself and for, you know, just on the side. Like, I would find myself, you know, at work, you know, shuffling cards for people, you know, doing charts and analyzing all sorts of things and getting really, really deep into it. I have calluses on my fingers from shuffling so much because I was using them as a tool to work planetary and global energy, you know, and then, of course, you know, personal stuff like relationships and health So I was having a lot of, you know, these very intense, you know, jobs, and it just seemed to make sense to just sort of move into this full-time. And basically, you know, I do progress charts, I do natal charts, I do transits, I do, you know, I focus in on things that not all astrologers focus in on, like the North and South Node, which talks about our deeper soul journey and things that connect with, you know, past lives and agreements that we have to reach a certain level of fruition on our path, or to make huge leaps and bounds on our journey, or to break, you know, contracts and agreements. You know, it's just that deeper stuff that nobody can really show us but our own inner voice. But it's very hard to hear that, so I help people bring clarity. And I'm really, you know, helping people flush out their creative channels of all other instructions and, you know, projections, so that, you know, they're only receiving the encoding of their dreams and visions and, you know, their own information and instruction, so that, you know, they can, you know, really manifest what they want. And of course, there's certain things that one connects with or makes an agreement to, and sometimes we have to learn the hard way that, you know, some of our plans aren't going to work out. You know, maybe it's too ego driven, but, you know, adversity, I help people handle the challenges and adversities and help them to see it from another perspective so that they can use it as a tool for empowerment, and also how they can view all the weapons and assaults and the things that we're up against as, you know, a tool for empowerment, because perception and empowerment and awakening and upgrading our DNA and understanding that we're the ultimate free energy technology, we can generate whatever reality it's like. And it's not that hard. We have to just be willing to unplug from the matrix. And so, you know, and I give as much as I can. You know, there's a lot of demand, but, you know, I do a sliding scale to work with people's budget. I also, if somebody's really, really, you know, in major crisis, I will be there. If I, you know, if I don't have other agreements with people that are also in major crisis, or you know, I do my best with all that. But basically, my website's cosmicgaiasophia.com. If you look under the readings link, you'll see, you know, the services, you know, the different things I do, and I just let the client kind of decide how they want to. I let them guide the process, and I, like I said, I have different tools and modalities. I also went to a clairvoyant institute for 2 years, and was in a state of meditation, you know, the whole time, really learned how to harness these abilities and then these other tools. And so, you know, it's a great package, and, you know, it's an hour, and then there's a 20-minute follow-up, and yeah, so it's my day job.
We all need those from time to time as we build our empires. It's like, all right, how do we get from point A to point B and just get food on the table and get gas in the car? And yeah, absolutely, and that's what we're all doing. It's just trying to find a way to take our passion and make that the thing that takes us, our, you know, our 40 to 50 hour work week that we care about, versus the thing we have to do just to get through month to month. You know, I guess then, Laura, I want to go back to something you mentioned in the beginning, because this is one of the most fascinating topics in the world to me, and that is exopolitics. I want to get back to that Weekly World News story. When you see the story, Eisenhower met with ETs, and you're like, well, yeah, of course. You said you knew it right away. Walk us through kind of the journey of finding that story, and how did you start gathering information about that, and what have you learned about the meetings with your great-grandfather and extraterrestrial beings?
I love the way you ask these questions. They're great. Okay, so that triggered, like, all right, something happened here. This is, you know, a true story, but I don't have total certainty that the way the story is told is actually true. So I need to really investigate. And people have to understand, you know, I wasn't born into this family because I'm an Ike fan. You know, there's big reasons, you know, as far as needing to expose this stuff and things, you know, based on larger mission stuff that seemed, you know, appropriate. I've been, you know, called a walk-in numerous times and whatever with the labels, but I know that I'm here to do real work, and I'm not going to, you know, hold back on the truth, even if it makes him look bad. But I have found out some really wonderful things and, you know, all the different things that he attempted to try and do to just steer things in the right direction. And, I mean, my God, we're up against so much and have been for thousands and thousands of years, and it's no easy task. So anyway, I guess the way it started to unfold is, you know, just keeping my eyes on everything related to UFOs, related to abductions, related to contact. And, you know, basically it's kind of, you know, when a seed is planted or something opens up, you know, it's easy to spot again and again and again. And I did have some interesting contact experiences with some benevolent beings when I was younger. I've never met Greys, but, you know,
were these angelic encounters, or was it something different? Was it something physical?
It seemed like an ET race. They're very luminous and bald, and I believe they were Arcturian. I didn't quite get the full, this is who we are, but when I looked at pictures, I'm like, that's them. And they're the ones that helped me to understand my path, and, you know, that I would, you know, they would try and take me away, and, you know, to stay strong in my truth, blah, blah, blah. And, of course, I relate that to the Mars thing. And, you know, I was very prepared. I mean, I knew my mission here on Earth, and I'm, you know, extremely attached to Mother Earth. I feel like a part of her. I mean, we all are. Some of us, though, are from different star systems. We don't connect as much. And, you know, that's okay. As long as we respect other life forms and we respect the ground we live on, you know, and all that kind of thing. But so my interest was piqued, and I had enough of my own stuff, and I, you know, very much acknowledge my multidimensional energy and just the astral traveling and the out-of-body experiences I've had. So, and it made sense. You know, things were starting to make sense. I'm like, okay, you know, it could have been any president that I might have been reading about, but I know that there's got to be some sort of connecting with off-planet beings and, you know, our governments because of the level of programming that exists. And those revelations came a little bit later. Like I said, everything was in stages. It's not like I was sitting there 5 or 6 or even 11 when I first saw it and had it all figured out, but, you know,
that was a moment where you were, you know, that slap in the face moment. You're like, huh, okay, that's interesting. But then you just put it back on the shelf for how long before you kind of really started digging back into that Ike and ET thing?
Well, the synchronicities were always there. Like I said, I always had my attention on anywhere that I saw UFO or ET, and then I would, you know, draw my interest and attention to it. And then just meeting people that had experiences and, you know, leaving, you know, high school and kind of getting out of that weirdness and, you know, exploring the world and just seeing what I naturally attract when I'm not stuck somewhere because I have to be there. You know, and I'm a big adventurer, and so a lot of the things that my path drew me to were, you know, things connected to this and understanding, you know, the ascension and, you know, our galactic history. And it just, you know, it was just like a snowball that grew and grew and grew and grew. But 2006 was a big one when I got recruited to Mars. Then I got really interested in, you know, understanding the negative ET agenda, because when I saw that headline, I didn't quite know the full story. I mean, meeting with ETs, that could have been any type of ET. I mean, even before the recruitment to Mars, you know, I had an understanding, okay, it was the Greys, and that didn't seem so good. What's going on with all this?
The Greys don't have a good track record, do they?
Not really, but there was about a 10-year period where I was researching and really getting a grip on this through whistleblower testimony, through, you know, people that have broken free of a lot of their super soldier programming, you know, who had been, you know, immersed in the Nazi stuff. You know, we've got people like Stuart Swerdlow, you know, who was a part of Montauk. We've got some super soldiers that broke their programming and put out a lot of information, you know, other whistleblowers. And I wrote an article, you can get it on my website, about what I assessed after all these years of research. That basically kind of breaks it all down and quotes, and, you know, it's basically the big whammy of all that I pulled together. But, you know, it was around, you know, the Mars recruitment that, you know, I was very interested in, okay, well, what's the Mars agenda? What's this Mars colony about? And, okay, it relates to Alternative 3. Okay, this relates to things in Ike's administration and, again, the ET question. And then, you know, something just exploded, and I'm, you know, understanding all this whistleblower testimony. I'm understanding what he was up against. I'm understanding the Mars timeline and how that got infiltrated, and whistleblowers like Dan Burrish. I mean, I just researched and researched and researched until I found, you know, common threads and consistency in certain places. And then, you know, went into a meditation, and I use my body, you know, kinesiology when it comes to the stuff I present, making sure my body's wisdom's in agreement. And then, you know, we have to figure it's not going to be 100%, but we all get as close as we can. You know, then I've seen channeled information. Some I discard, and some I just feel a deep resonance with. You know, and a lot of times, you know, because of my ability to be at events and speak, I've gotten the opportunity to get to know a lot of, you know, different people that have put out information, and, you know, I get to feel into them and see what they're about, and so that's helped. But the Mars recruitment, you know, really helped me to understand things like my labs and artificial telepathy and psychotronic weaponry. And I came to understand that I was pre-targeted before birth with things called looking glass technologies. And basically, I was targeted to be brought into the Mars timeline. And somebody was set up to recruit me into it who had been targeted. And they knew that we had a past life together and that there was natural affinity. Because I'm not just going to fall for some agent that, you know, I'm not, I would hope to think I'm not that sort of easily taken.
Gullible.
But, right. And so there was a natural chemistry and connection in past lives, and the languaging that we spoke, I mean, we were so in sync. So my idea was, okay, I'm gonna convince him that we need to be on Earth. And his idea was we have to go to Mars no matter what, target date 2012. And so I'm thinking, okay, well, who are the people that he's having these secret meetings with? Who are they? And there was nothing really written up about them, and I just did a ton of research, and they're connected to MJ-12. Which are the ones that have all the alien technology. And so basically, the negative ET agenda when it comes to the Greys originated with Aleister Crowley, Churchill, and Hitler. And I will be putting out a lot more information so people can, you know, like, handle this or process it. And I'm not saying that Crowley didn't have his years of putting out profound genius, but, I mean, he was linked with the negative ET agenda starting in Atlantean times, and that whole timeline was starting to be constructed with a lot of the rituals. And you know, when you're dealing with some of these sort of controls, you know, perhaps he had alters where, you know, people would see one side, but he's, you know, also playing this other role or character. But anyway, Roosevelt was the first president to sign a treaty with the Greys. Abductions had already been happening before Eisenhower had anything to do with this encounter. And I've gotten this from about four different sources and also channelers, whistleblowers, channelers. And so that, beyond a shadow of a doubt, is a pretty strong hit. The treaties supposedly get renewed every 10 years, and when Eisenhower was in office, they were presenting themselves as a dying race. They needed help. The treaty was broken. They ended up taking it much further, and it got out of control. But, you know, Dan Burst, the whistleblower, has said that the Greys are future human selves time-traveling back to abduct individuals to get their genetic material to save their dying race because they're not able to ascend like us.
Say that one more time. Let's say that one more time.
They are not able to ascend like us because they unplugged from source and started to plug into us, you know, and to be like energy vampires. And they started to compromise their DNA like way thousands and thousands of years ago so that they could always maintain control. But then the ones that followed them ended up turning into and digressing into Greys. They lost their reproductive capacity. They lost their emotionality. And so the abductions have to do with rebuilding themselves and trying to get some sense of freedom. So in a way, it's like, yeah, we kind of want to help, but then when you see the hostility and the fact that the treaties were broken, it's a whole different ballgame. So I wouldn't say Ike sold us out. We got sold out a while ago. Now it's been more about what do we do now? And that's what he was up against. The Mars agenda got infiltrated. At first, it was going to be all about, you know, protecting the human genome and getting our DNA safe in the event of cataclysm. Now it's about a breakaway civilization where they're hoarding all the alien technology and we're on Earth experiencing either extinction or New World Order while they're simulating an Armageddon scenario with things like HARP and, you know, their ability to create superstorms and, you know, control weather. So we have to understand how our vital life force and our kundalini is tapped into and siphoned so that they can power these things up. And if we could just get that energy back, we can collapse this whole system and matrix. This is the hot spot time, this window period, to make really important choices about whether we're going to digress into Greys, whether we're going to serve some negative ET agenda unconsciously because we refuse to look at the truth, or if we really want to advance ourselves and become like ascended masters or become, you know, higher beings that live in crystal cities, either underground or somewhere else. You know, and so it's important that we really embrace, you know, a lot of the stuff about ascension, but then, you know, we also have to be careful of New Age deceptions in programming. So I just say, hey, I really want to help people with their inner work to help them know themselves. That way they are functioning like a vehicle that just came out of the shop, where their intuition's, you know, in good shape, their power is in good shape, their vehicle is ready to go. And if they've got that going for them, then they're going to be in a lot better shape than, you know, trying to figure out who's the best person to follow. Like, enough with the following. Like, we're all leaders. You know, we all have a special gift. And so that's, you know, what I'm seeing. And my goal is to just sort of unify that, you know, our diversity and harmony to me is true oneness. And the prerequisite to unity consciousness is finding ourselves and honoring, you know, who we are and what our own truth is, while we learn about these greater truths connected to, you know, some of this other stuff. And with multiple timelines, though, and multiple realities, it's really hard to pinpoint one exact truth. So we also kind of have to let go a little bit and just, you know, really work on, you know, the rebalancing. And then we'll get downloaded what we need to, and we can just have our own experience, and we'll be around other matches of what is on our vibratory level. We'll find our true love, and whoever's on a different path doing it differently, great. They're on a different level of their soul journey too, or we're all, you know, but it all leads to the same source. And that's what this creation and this particular planetary body was designed to do as an ascension planet, to help us to return to source after we sank and fell, you know, the original Atlantis and Lemuria that fell into this lower density. You know, the goddess morphed into this physical planet to assist us in returning home, but then that's where the controller groups have stepped in and are trying to make it extremely difficult. And we don't have to look at it as some figure or some personification. I mean, it's energy, and we have the blueprint within us. And, you know, it's nature, it's cosmos, it's everything, it's energy. And, you know, belief systems are one thing, but really living it and experiencing it and understanding, you know, how it all kind of works, you know, is a really liberating thing. You know, understanding that the physical body gives us symptoms to help us heal, not, you know, try and crush us with some diagnosis. It gives us necessary signals. I mean, the Matrix has been taking advantage of all the different initiations that could have helped us to advance a long time ago. And we're spinning our wheels, you know, with belief systems that, you know, really damage us and separate us from ourselves and, you know, spirit and nature.
I want to talk about the past lives. There's a lot of people listening for the first time to... It's interesting because we've been doing this radio show for 4 years, and someday is somebody's first experience ever listening to stuff that I'm doing. And that's, you know, because it's like I've been on this journey for a while, and it's like I just kind of expect, well, you know, if you've been here with me for 4 years, you will know where I'm coming from. It's like, no. People are taking this in for the first time today. Always someone new finds the product. And, you know, I've been following this and been down the, you know, the coast-to-coast AM path of really pushing boundaries and trying to think more analytically and metaphysically for about 15, 20 years. So it's hard to talk about current political stuff or exopolitics and stuff back to your great-grandfather's administration without understanding past lives and what this experience is on this planet. Because for all of the things we waste our time on, a lot of people still have a hard time figuring out who are we, why are we here, what are we supposed to do while we're here, and what happens when we leave here. So can you just talk about past lives for a little bit? Because there's a lot of people out there that really have either just shut that down as a possibility, they were raised something differently and indoctrinated to some sort of different belief, and they just don't even entertain the thought, or they're just oblivious to the fact that this might not be the first time we've been to Disneyland. We just don't remember it. We've been flashy thinged like in Men in Black, and we're like, huh? Okay, I don't remember what. All right, let's go. And you don't remember those memories. So just talk about past lives in any way you want to, because it's crucial to kind of start putting the pieces of this puzzle together, I think.
Yeah, definitely. And we do have amnesia. I mean, we don't really remember, and some people do. I mean, you know, the blocks can sometimes be because there was too much trauma in a past life, but then the blocks might lift because there's a true love, you know, we just ran into, and all of a sudden we're getting images of being in Avalon or being, you know, in Atlantis, and it's like, where did that come from? You know, and so people really need to live their life experience with an open mind, and, you know, it takes it hitting home for people to really shift their belief systems, similar to, like, you know, aliens and ETs and, you know, chemtrails. It might have to, like, really affect your brother or cousin for you to give it to the time of day. Because if it's not really affecting anybody you know around you, it's easy to just blow off. It's when it starts to, you know, hit close to home that we start to pay attention. Now, past lives, there's something in the astro chart that basically is all about past lives. It's an astro aspect. It's called the South Node. The South Node is, the opposite of that is the North Node. And basically, they're not planets, but it's a line of energy that forms a circle. Symbolically, it's like the Ouroboros, the serpent biting its tail. And we're always wanting to move forward into the North Node. And the South Node is basically what we've learned along the way, what we've accumulated, what gifts and abilities we've developed, but also what challenges and ruts we might not be able to break free of that might be rooted in past lives that make it very difficult to move forward and make that next step happen. And that's when people feel very lost, or they keep digressing, or they just can't seem to emerge. And so people don't realize that they're operating very much from past life memories. A lot of the patterning in our lives is connected to it. A lot of our destiny and the things that we reach are based on how we're able to take things from the past to the next level. And, you know, sometimes we don't really know this till we call attention to it, and we formulate other excuses, or we just run for the first pharmaceutical that's offered to us, and we detach from it, and we lose all connection. I mean, the thing is, with inner work, meditation, eating well, and taking good care of ourselves, I think people are going to run into this, you know, just on their life path, just that familiarity and those remembrances. But when one looks at the South Node like I do in people's chart, I see everything from traumas in past lives to broken relationships and trauma connected to that. I see incredible gifts and abilities, and different, you know, challenges and different opportunities. And basically, you know, it shows sort of karmic imbalances, you know, or like a missing link. Was there something that you weren't able to do to complete your mission? Then you come back and you're still working at it. You know, that's my kind of chart, you know, that I have. I was not able to complete my mission in the last couple thousands of years, so I keep coming back on the same mission, which I'm doing right now. You know, and other people, you know, have their different things, and I see it every day in charts. And so, and I read past lives, and so, you know, it's like telling somebody who's been abducted that there's no such thing as abduction. It's like, once you've lived it enough, there's no question about it. I think people need to try it out and experience it, because there's a lot of people that didn't feel a resonance to it that got a reading from me and were like, oh my God, that makes so much sense. Okay. That's why this patterning is there. And then we help to, you know, remove the connection to the past life memories that are keeping one locked in trauma. We help to bring in the wisdom and message to help, you know, it be integrated so the person can move forward. And then the gifts and abilities, it's like, well, we don't need to disrupt that too much. But it's always about moving forward. We want to take our gifts and abilities to the next level. We want to experience sort of the opposite so we can complete the wheel and graduate from the wheel and get into that zero point. And so the nodes in our deeper soul journey is going through all these different incarnations for a reason, to wear all these different hats, to eventually be able to assess it all and say, hey, all right, I get it enough now. And then we find some sort of wholeness and balance with it all. And then, hey, we're in the center of the wheel, not all these different pieces of the pie. The pieces of the pie are maybe the different lifetimes and different themes that we've played out. And this is a big time of being in completion, you know, where we don't really need anymore. So, you know, oh my God, oh no, you might want to talk, let me mute, because I'm going to have
All right, as long as you're okay, because if I need to call somebody, I'll call somebody. I hope you just swallowed a bug or something there. No, but we're talking with Laura Eisenhower.
I had a nut. Okay, I'm good.
All right, I was just going to say, check out her website, CosmicGaiaSophia.com. Hopefully I said that right.
Yeah, and for me, like, there is no past life, it's one big lifetime, you know, I don't even notice the in-betweens. Okay, fine, I was a baby and a kid for a little while, but I live like the past lives were yesterday. It's like we are all our past lives in one body right now. Sorry to say, interrupt again.
No, it's just because I don't remember a past life, yet I have, there's nothing about hearing that where I would say, oh, there's no way that's true. I would never shut down over a comment like that, because it just kind of seems like if I'm not supposed to graduate from here, and you keep coming back till you get it right, almost like quantum leap, you keep going on journeys until you one leap finally brings you home.
I think you have a completely different scenario where you don't necessarily need to know that you, more than likely, you've cleared a lot of patterning. You don't need to go back. I don't think.
What does that mean? Clearing a lot of patterning.
Okay, like there might be patterning where, you know, you were, say you were connected to the Nazis, or you were connected to, you know, a particular illness that you experienced more than once, or an ancestral pattern that you keep repeating, or a relationship scenario that has been a theme for many, many lifetimes.
Like you get stuck in a loop, and it's like a hamster wheel or something.
Yeah. And that's when we don't move from our south node to our north node. And so I help people get on the trail and move towards their destiny, because destiny is there waiting. But if we're spiraling and digressing into stuff, you know, it's going to be difficult. I've read plenty of charts where there's barely anything connecting a person to the past. They don't have really any memories, but I notice and see that that person, you know, has spent lifetimes in other dimensions, other star systems. And, you know, I could give you a reading sometime, you know, and we can look in it, but...
All right, I'm in. By the way, I'll raise my hand for that. I will volunteer. Sure.
And look at what you're doing in the world. You are right in the center of the wheel in a lot of ways. I mean, the level of awareness you have, and just, I mean, and just your energy and just your heart and everything. It's you're in really in great shape. I mean, we have amnesia for a reason. But sometimes we do need to know and take a peek, and sometimes we don't. And sometimes, you know, we're from the future, and I read lifetimes that take me into the future instead of the past, so it's not even a past life. It's very interesting. I've seen all sorts of things. I've seen things where people aren't physical bodies. I've seen things that are very abstract. I've seen things that are very detailed and story-orientated. I could, you know, find a similar scenario in history, you know, if I Googled. Well, it would help if history wasn't being rewritten by time-traveling Nazis, but, you know.
Time-traveling. You know, I just talked with Jim Mars. I talked with him at the Conscious Life Expo as well. And... You know, he does a lot of work with the Nazis and a lot of the ancient aliens. If you watch it on TV, you know, I mean, it'll talk about the Eisenhower and the president's meeting with extraterrestrial beings and setting up different agreements that may or may not have been broken, as you were talking about. And the Nazis having such a weird role in history, bringing back all of those symbols and all those powers and all that ancient wisdom that they were seeking down, like if you remember Harrison Ford going out in Indiana Jones and all those adventures. I mean, that was really what the Nazis were up to. I mean, looking back now at what Nazis did and what they're currently doing, I can't let that just linger there. Talk about the time travel, talk about the Nazis, talk about the stuff they were getting into, and talk about how it's still relevant today.
Well, that's a big question, so I'm not going to be able to cover all bases on that, and I'm still very much, you know, learning a lot too. You know, it goes back to root races, you know, the Atlantean root race. And we have to understand that root races are different than the original Atlantis and Lemuria. When we sank into this lower density, the 12 tribes got seeded, and we were, you know, on a path of 7 different root races and 5 cloister races. And basically our ascension was going to happen over a longer period of time, because when we did have a high capacity of DNA, we still sank and fell. So that didn't really work. So a human experiment, a new sort of idea came into the mix. Not everybody was in agreement to it, and some wars broke out that almost killed the planet completely. And so new seedings of humans had to happen, and eventually it ended up getting sort of a very strong patriarchal slant. There was a lot of competition about who's the chosen one and whose root race or whose codes are more important. And then, like, the control agendas and just the reptilian invasion and just the infiltrations, it wasn't even about that anymore. It was like, okay, it was about the targeting of the Jews, because the Hebrews carry a very important code that we are supposed to, and we have in many ways, receive. Because the thing is, if we're ascending over a long period of time, different groups, you know, are born, you know, we can see them as generations, and something is passed along. Just like my kids give me something and they give their generation something, and the elders, you know, we all give each other something. So it's there's always sort of this competition and insecurity, it seems, from the Nazis about the chosen one. And when the Hebrews came into the picture, it was after the Atlantean root race had its, you know, power with, you know, some of these agendas and some of these ideas with, you know, genetic manipulation and, you know, putting in very advanced technology to make it very difficult for us to unify and ascend. And they act like it's all about some one world order that has some sort of spiritual overlays, you know, Madame Blavatsky and, you know, some of the occult stuff and ritual stuff that at times we might have, you know, said, hey, is there something spiritual going on here? Well, you know, major infiltration of Hitler, and I believe, you know, Crowley was the original, and then, you know, Churchill got brought in, and it was basically feeding on the fractures where, you know, greed and power, you know, ended up being more important, which made it easy for these entities to plug in. And then we're dealing with, you know, Illuminati stuff where they trauma-based mind control individuals to keep them locked in the reptilian DNA and to prevent them from accessing the Orifim consciousness, which would help them to heal the species that are trying to enslave us. And they actually had a rebellion and didn't want to be healed, which is why, you know, the structure of the 13 families came about, and power ended up just being corrupt instead of benevolent and a force of guidance. And so hierarchy and structures don't really work, period. But when you have, you know, fallen angelics and we're in a free will universe, you get all sorts of things. So the Nazis basically have been, they've had their hands on all sorts of technologies because of the extraterrestrials they've been working with. I mean, these technologies have been in the works for a long time. I had a reading the other day where somebody said that a time travel group contacted me in Atlantis to strategize this window period, and they were from the future and met with me in Atlantis. I'm like, okay, that sounds kind of cool. You know, but I'm not one to fix beliefs like rock solid. I'm like, okay, you know, and so when we're dealing with time travel, you know, you're dealing with groups that, you know, want everything to be okay, and then you're dealing with ones that, you know, are trying to manipulate the human race and set up scenarios, and basically they use technologies to gauge how humanity is going to react to certain events. And when we look at the Illuminati and we look at war, we're dealing with Zionism and Nazism and, you know, things like 9/11 to create an Armageddon artificial timeline. You know, even though it happened, it engages us on a level that makes it very confusing because there's no real truth and we have to find the truth ourselves. So that was a big catalyst. They shot themselves in the foot, but there's a lot that's still going on. Superstorms, things like Sandy Hook, things, you know, that are obvious, you know, false flags. And you know, we see that Mars reality show of people going to Mars. That, to me, is absolute BS. And then the people climbing out of the window naked, Buckingham Palace. So, you know, what the hell's going on here? I don't think that was a hoax.
Yeah, but that Buckingham Palace thing was weird. And then you go down the rabbit hole of what Clinton's doing with Jeffrey Epstein on secret islands of pedophilia and sex slaves. And you're like, give me a break.
And this is what these people do. So how can we possibly make excuses for them when this is what they do? You know, so who cares about hoax or not hoax? Let's talk about the facts that people have been victimized by them, and these are true stories. Like, we get so distracted with, oh, it's different than the image on Google Earth. It's like, that's the hoax to me, to completely get us off topic. But anyway, so the Nazis with their technology, they made an agreement with the Greys. The Nordics had presented themselves, and they were very much about the Aryan, you know, blood and preserving it, and the blue-eyed blondes, and so they related to these races. But then, you know, something sort of weird happened because it was kind of never about that. I mean, the whole reason that they don't want, I mean, they talk about racial purity, but then they're misogynists, and it's all about the advancement of creating a superhuman based on technology and plugging everybody into artificial intelligence. And there's nothing natural like about it. But I mean, it is natural because if it's happening, it originates somewhere. But it's artificial in the sense that it plays on us. And you know, it's kind of like being in a relationship where the person's cheating the whole time and you believe them. It's artificial. It's not real. There's no honesty or integrity. And so the Nazis are power hungry. They want to run the show. They want to create a new world order. They wanted to wipe out the Hebrews. And basically they were building and have been building superhumans. And, you know, basically if anybody has seen the Hunger Games, that's kind of the picture of what they want it to be, is, you know, a small percentage, you know, having everything and then the rest not. And they have managed to make it look like it's the Jews. They've managed to create sort of Zionism as the front. And now new propaganda is coming out, making Hitler look good, making Eisenhower look like a war criminal. And I've been working with psychic mediums who said Eisenhower never commanded harming any innocent people. You know, but there's all these rumors. And I'm like, well, why are they coming out now about death camps? And why, you know, is all this propaganda about Hitler and the Nazis, and people are eating it up? You know, and I'm like, this is time travel manipulation right here. And it's not like I'm choosing sides here. I want the Nazis to heal. I want to embrace all parties, the Germans, the Nazis, the Jews. I want this war to end. You know, I'm not here to pick sides, and I never was. Let's all drop this and, like, look at each other and look at what's happening and, not let ourselves be puppeted or on the strings of the puppet masters anymore. And there's Nazis that were some Nazi, like, sent me, like, a request to date him, and I'm like, a Nazi hitting on an Eisenhower? Like, who would have thought?
I could see a reality show in that one. I think it'll be on E! That'd be fantastic. A Nazi dates an Eisenhower. No, you're so right about that.
Well, that's not going to happen, but it just was so surreal. And he had all the propaganda. His cover photo was the whole army with Hitler, his he has a swastika for the profile picture, and I'm like, oh my God, what do I do? Anyway, sorry, I just had to.
Well, you take him out for, you make sure he gets you a nice steak is what you do. No, I think it's interesting how you were talking about, like, whatever's going on, let's just stop it and figure out. I've been thinking this for the past few weeks, is like, I really don't want to think about all of these things anymore. I want to negotiate the ceasefire. Enough killing and dominating. I want to negotiate a ceasefire. What will it take for everybody to calm down? And does that mean that the other side has to die? You know, are you saying you must die and there's no other way? We just got to figure out the ceasefire. I want to get back to 9/11. You said that they shot themselves in the foot. Because 9/11 really was the first domino. Well, it's like the beginning of a chapter. It's the first chapter of, first page on a new chapter of a book that's been going on for a long time. But I think the beginning of this chapter, the domino got flicked on 9/11. You said they shot themselves in the foot. And then here we are, how many years later? 14 years later. We have ISIS, the Jews, you have Islam, we're talking about Hitler, we have the surveillance state, the Orwellian wars that never stopped, the Illuminati, the One World Government, Agenda 21. Can you talk about what you meant when you said they shot themselves in the foot? And walk it forward to ISIS today and the Jews, because it's like we can't get out of this damn scenario. It's like the same script keeps replaying. It's just things slightly tweak themselves, and I really went off the hamster wheel already.
I almost can't even follow anything that's currently happening with ISIS. But what I mean is, if you're going to create an event like that, and basically, you know, the people that the system has educated, like the architects and engineers that put out a video that says it's impossible for this to happen, you know, it begins to open people's eyes to the concept of false flag. So there's some sort of crack that allows some kind of light to shine in to make people ask a lot of questions, for people to, you know, see, you know, Bush, Cheney, and Rumsfeld, and the Clintons, and everybody else with, you know, I mean, there's just a chain reaction. It's like, I mean, Lee McCloskey, who's an actor, he was a soap actor, he was in the movie, the soap opera Dallas. When 9/11 happened, he painted his whole upstairs, the whole creation story. And basically, he painted it in 3D, he didn't do it on any canvas, and basically, it created a breakthrough in him that allowed him to create a whole tarot deck. I should send, if you don't know who I'm talking about, I'll send you pictures.
No, tell me again, who is this guy? What was he, what's
Lee,
his?
Lee McCloskey, L-E-I-G-H. And then McCloskey, and he lives in Malibu. He's an actor. He was on The Love Boat. He was on, you know, all these soaps. And I've become, you know, good friends with him. I go to his house on a regular basis. He's painted the whole creation story pretty much in 3D and had no idea what he was painting. And he said that he started when 9/11 happened.
Oh, like it was just channeled through him, and it was like, I need to start painting, and then months
yeah,
go by, and you're
talking,
like...
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, I was just saying, and months go by, and you're like, oh my gosh, I like, this is still channeling through me. There's a big project coming out.
And he's still painting. And that was, you know, 14 years ago. So he's still painting, and he has people to his house, and he explains it like it was, I just went there, you know, after not being there for a while, and he's just as exuberant, just as brilliant, and basically it taught him. He had no idea what he was doing, and it's all symbolic, and all the goddess archetypes, everything about, you know, the whole creation story, like, and it almost proves, like, everything, and it's like, how did this happen anyway? So 9/11 bust him down and open, and a lot of people had really, really profound awakening experiences, because all of a sudden, you know, we're seeing reality in a completely different way. And there's a lot of manipulation as far as how we're going to view that reality. But, you know, there's plenty of beings that were able to step back and access something that is very beneficial to the rest of humanity. And so I guess what I mean is they shot themselves in the foot, because whatever they tried to achieve ended up kind of backfiring. And even though we see all this struggle and turmoil, you know, let's look at the next election, because my mission right now is to make sure everybody is educated about who Hillary Clinton really is. And I'm going to do whatever it takes to take that woman down, because she is a criminal. This is not about politics anymore. She's had sex slaves. Kathy O'Brien has written a book called Transformation of America that describes all the abuse she was under. You know, that Hillary Clinton, you know, is... I mean, it blows my mind that people are going to go vote for, you know, people that are like Jeffrey Dahmer that should be locked up. And so I'm not going to, that's not going to fly. And so anyway, I'm going to see what I can do. I've come up with some ideas, and then it's like, oh, that might not work. So I'm still kind of like, okay, you know.
I'm in the boat, Laura. I'm hoping that we can get a pledge from people to just say, all right, in 2016, no more Clinton, no more Bush. That's
exactly.
It. Just let's start with, I'm good with the oligarchy thing. I'm all right. I'll try anything else. I'll throw a dart blindly in the dark. I'd rather just pick a name out of a phone book. I'm okay on the oligarchy. I have already decided I will never vote for a Clinton or a Bush again. Like, that's done. That's not even a possibility for me. So I'm with you in this campaign.
I want to get their faces on America's Most Wanted, and I want people to know, you know, who Kathy O'Brien is, who's a friend of mine, who just, you know, it's just unbelievable what people have gone through. I mean, Clinton, he's not in his right mind. These people are possessed by demons, and so we need a major exorcism. That should be our focus instead of voting these people into office again. And I'm sorry, you know, the human race has got to freaking wake up, because it's really up to us. And, you know, calling people like us crazy or ignoring the information and allowing pedophiles to run this planet, seeing naked people jump out of a window, hearing cases of victimized children under the hands of the Vatican or the Catholic priests, it's like, if we don't all do something, you know, I'm blown away that there's not more concerned people that are taking a stand. It's like, where does the instinct go? Like, you know, like, I'm a parent. I've got that parent instinct. I'm not going to allow my kid in the room with anybody who's like that, let alone somebody that, you know, might run for office. And so, you know, I'm just going to get louder, and I'm just going to keep doing what I'm doing, and you're going to keep doing what you're doing, which makes a huge impact and difference. And I know by the time 2016 rolls around, we're going to take all this down, and we're going to start a whole new system and a whole new paradigm. And whatever is breathing all this conflict in, you know, with ISIS and all this other stuff with the, you know, with the Jews and, you know, the things that come straight from the Illuminati and leaders like Hillary, or not leaders, excuse me, parasites, like her, you know, we have to be the ones that vote for ourselves and vote for this planetary body. And we've got, we only have like a year and a half. And, so anyway,
yeah, they're already all announcing their campaigns officially, and it's like, this, for some reason, some people think this woman just skated past Benghazi, skated past who gets kicked off of the Nixon trial for shady ethics? Hillary Clinton. Like we're not surprised 50 years later that this old woman really wants to be the first woman, and that's really all she has going for her, is to divide the country, male versus female, and be like, oh, I'm going to be the first female. Yep, see, I'm therefore qualified. It's like, no, there are many very qualified women that could be president. Not you, miss.
Yeah.
Not you.
Yeah, she's insane. She's a criminal. She's a psychopath, and she needs to be taken to the dark side of Pluto. I don't know. You know, where to take these people. They are not in their right minds. They are dangerous. They should not be on the streets. If it was anybody else, they would be spending life in prison. And there has got to be justice, or it's bullshit. And the thing is, if we get past 2016 and one of these people are voted into office, this is planet joke to me. And I'm just going to have to detach, because you know what, humans, you brought it upon yourself. Like, you ignored the warnings.
Man.
You ignored, you know, all the different, you know, you've got your head so in the matrix and so in the programming that, you know, I mean, yeah, universal love and forgiveness, whatever, but I'm going to need a little while.
Hey, you know what? I was saying the same thing after two times putting Obama into office, after two times putting Bush in. You shake your head, you just kind of, you run out of words to say, and it's like, I don't know what we do from here. But, you know, I'm very curious to hear about you explain the mission. Because I feel that this way too. It's kind of I saw a good quote, and I don't know who to attribute it to. So, you know, anyone wants to look it up and leave a comment, that's cool. But it was along the lines of, activism is the rent that we pay to live on this planet. And I don't know why. I don't know why I care so much. I know that I care a lot more than I did before 9/11. So that's why I was so interested in how you said that, you know, they shot themselves in the foot. Because I mean, I've always been a curious person. I've always followed politics, but never down the rabbit holes that I've been following it for the past 15 years.
Yeah.
I can't believe how deep this stuff goes.
I know. It's unbelievable. I have a tent in the rabbit hole. I live in the rabbit hole. It's like the rabbits, they're raising me right now.
Kindred spirits. But the mission, talk about the mission, like that desire, that drive. When did you first discover it, and how does it feel? So does it feel as strong as it ever did? Is it more strong? Does it wane? Does it go up and down, or...
It never really goes away. The only time is when I'm so exhausted that I get some sleep, and then I dream about it. I wake up with it. I mean, you know, anybody who knows me, that I've, you know, my partner, Dr. Dream, he can attest to this. I mean, we're not, like, you know, living together right now, but he witnessed it every day. It never really gets turned off. And, you know, it was, you know, since I was a kid, but it morphs and changes depending on, you know, what's in front of me and what part of me is, you know, just feeling triggered into action. You know, sometimes it's about the masculine and feminine, and sometimes it's about the ET, but I'm putting it all in one big package, because for us to feel whole, we have to see that there's an interrelatedness of all this. There's this big mandala we can't compartmentalize that keeps us fragmented. So I've always had this. I mean, and I've always been amazed by how strong it is, and it's just lifetimes and lifetimes, and yeah, I'm exhausted. And I also have a ton of compassion. I mean, you know, I understand that people would vote if they don't know what's truly going on behind the scenes, and they haven't gone down the rabbit hole.
Because I'm 20 years in, and I'm only just now starting to get a sense of just how connected this is. It takes a long time to study this, way more than a master's or a doctorate, way longer.
Right. But see, the thing is, you know, I believe that our heart and our intention is stronger than if we get duped, you know? Like, obviously, if this person goes to war and is serving their country but doesn't realize that they're serving a bunch of parasitic, you know, Illuminatist, satanic, ritualistic people that are trying to, you know, pull the strings, you know, they're not going to pay for that. They're going to feel reward. They're going to get rewarded for their heart's intentions, not for being duped. You know, I feel a deep connection with just trying to help people through this stuff. I accept a lot of criticism and a lot of hateful things thrown at me. I understand that this is a major purging and a major shock. And I know that, you know, just like you said, it takes years and years and years just to wrap one's head around it. You know, here you are voting, wanting to help the planet, wanting to make sure the right person's in office, and now you've opened a doorway, and it's a completely different world. But, I mean, think of your good intentions back then. So you don't have to pay the price for the fact that you were duped. But if we carry around, like, you know, a lot of negative intentions and we're greedy, yeah, we're going to have to fall on our face and learn a few lessons. And, you know, and we all, like, have that, you know, we all have our moments with certain things, you know, with our negative ego here and there. But the point is, like, when it comes down to now that there's all this evidence, this is, you know, a time to really just be able to turn people's attention around, whereas it was a lot more hidden, the stories weren't written, and it was a lot harder back when you were voting. And I just couldn't make it to the voting office. I've been so out there trying to get grounded and, you know, like, working one dimension at a time, and then I see this one, and, like, it's just been nothing but shock. It's so much worse than I actually thought, even though I had a great concept of what the bigger picture, you know, like I said, when I was young, I could see what was going on, but it is so much worse than I could have ever imagined. And, you know, and I think we all have to go through a crisis and release, you know, all sorts of things. You know, whatever our reality used to be crumbles, we have to be rebirthed, we have to rebuild, and reset our foundation. And that information that we're finding out about is doing it. But the person we were before is no greater or better. It's just, you know, as long as the heart was intact back then, I don't think we're carrying, you know, any karmic residue. But if we go through a huge shift in the transformation where we change on multiple levels, we can only be rewarded. And if, you know, we keep running into the same pattern over and over again, there's plenty of help and assistance. So the mission is just so multidimensional. The mission is to inspire, to empower, to unify, you know, and to really, you know, understand myself and understand, you know, things completely and totally. And, you know, basically, Gaia Sophia, seated as an ascension planet, my goal and mission is to assist this planet in moving to the next level. I'm very much about being active and creative, and so if there's something that isn't working out, you know, being strategic and coming up with a new plan. I was told by at least three different people that I was a spirit guide to Ike, you know, during the Second World War, and he's a spirit guide to me as far as connecting with a lot of the hidden stuff, and just, it's like, you know, we're sort of like mediators, you know, between certain things. And we've been allies, and we've been helping each other for a long time. So my mission is very wrapped up in, you know, him. And, you know, sometimes I just want to defend him and help people to understand what kind of man he truly was, but I don't really feel like that's the mission. You know, he could, I mean, if I was, I just have come to realize what an incredible individual this is, you know, starting off like not too concerned, you know, if I don't even like my family, because I'm self-sufficient enough and rebellious enough to get by on my own and blow the whistle on my family if need be. But I've absolutely, like, been blown away by all that I've discovered about him and what people have helped me. So the mission is sacred union, inner balance, global alchemy, educating the masses, unifying the masses, assisting them in my one-on-one sessions to really know the truth about who they are and how they can participate, and getting our sovereignty back and being able to come and go from the physical as we please and explore this beautiful multidimensional creation that we're in and not be enslaved. And, you know, and the thing is, you know, certain people who are running their energy without integrity, you know, are going to have to work out some karmic glitches. And, you know, I just want to help accelerate that for them so that they don't have to manifest a future that's might, you know, siphon away their soul and make it very difficult to get themselves back and get home.
I run into, you know, some of these people that just have no, they just don't have that compass, that internal give a damn. You know, it's beyond selfish. It's actually really weird because, you know, I'm fiercely independent. I fight and I scrap for what I have, which some say is selfish. It's like, well, if you're not going to be your own advocate, who do you expect to be? You know, you need to stand up for yourself and do stuff. But, like, I run into people, they seem rudderless. They seem like they're navigating a boat without any steering. They're just kind of on the whims of where the wind takes them in a weird, selfish, and kind of oblivious way. And I don't know.
That's so well put. Oh, my God.
I like to think I'm a wiser person now because I'm a few years removed from the 18-year-old that knew everything. Now I know nothing, it seems like. But
your heart is so wise and you're so present, and that's where the ultimate knowledge and truth is. Anyway,
well, one of the big connectors between your family tree, from where things were with treaties, the past wars that we've been through and false flags and all the manipulation when they used to control all of the media, unlike today. Of course, Obama net's coming down the road. So if you like your internet, you can keep it. Remember that, kids. You let the FCC do that a couple weeks ago. But there's a phrase, military-industrial complex. Eisenhower is perhaps known most famously for that warning to the country and to the planet, I guess, to the world, or to the atmosphere and the universe. When I say military-industrial complex, what does that mean to you? When he said it then, what you know about what he was trying to say, what was actually going on, and how it's manifesting itself in 2015?
Okay, that's a good question. The tough thing with me is I wasn't a good student. I haven't read that many books in my life. I very much look in the index, though, and put pieces and dots together and look at maybe multiple books and get a little piece from different things based on what, you know, stuff is coming into me and what, you know, is making itself known. And that I feel safe with and comfortable with. I mean, it's not that I couldn't read. It's just, yeah, my attention has always been just trying to get a grip on my mission and just writing and just sharing and, you know, I've skimmed through a lot of stuff, haven't been able to read enough. So I might not be able to give the definition based on how somebody might write a book about it. But when I hear that speech, when I connect into it, you know, to me,
because
it's
a powerful speech. It's a really, it's almost like you could see the gun behind the curtain, and it's like, say this thing.
Yeah.
And he was just up there and he just kind of let this rip. He's like, guys, I got to warn you, if you don't watch out, the military industrial complex is going to be running the affairs of this planet forever. Peace out.
I love it. I get the goosebumps.
Oh, yeah.
The lump in my throat. I might have, you know, been a spirit guide helping him write that for all I know based on what the latest readings I've gotten, but, you know, I'm not trying to pat myself on the back here for it, but who cares anyway. But when I hear, you know, that speech and what he meant is, you know, basically, you know, the transhumanism agenda, really the machine, you know, the artificial intelligence, the mind control, you know, the enslavement of humanity, just everything being weaponized, you know, we're being weaponized, nature's being weaponized, and you know, there's a greater power than these technologies that is embedded in the earth and in us. And the earth is just waiting for us to get it. And she's almost like sacrificing a portion of her multidimensional body to push us, you know, to watch us get pushed to the edge and to hold space for us and not, you know, annihilate us so that we can come back around and get everything back on track. And so I think he's definitely like calling light to, you know, a trail that we could all walk down if we lose connection with nature and we allow these, like these bozos to run the show, and with all the secrecy about UFOs and ETs, you know, it's like a cancer growing from underneath. You know, we hear about abductions and people that are supporting them and helping them, like John Mack, you know, gets killed in a car accident, William Cooper gets killed, Philip Schneider gets killed, and there's no way to really live in a world where whatever he was warning us about can be processed and understood or voted for or talked about. It's all manipulated, it's all deception, it's all secrecy, and it's all these hidden agendas with these facades, you know, like now, you know, all these other facades to keep our attention on something so we think that, you know, we're progressing or we're covering, you know, things that maybe on an intuitive level we feel we're ready for, but it's distorted and it's screwed up. So, you know, it's basically the artificial world versus the one that is all about, you know, our soul development, our spiritual development. And he was a very spiritual being, and, you know, the military, you know, has been working with ETs, and they're dealing with all sorts of manipulations and implants and traumas and abductions, and, you know, basically this is trying to take over and completely suffocate and basically turn this planet into something completely different. You know, it's like knocking out everything that's natural. I see it almost like somebody on a life support system, you know, and the question is, can, you know, a good diet and a holistic lifestyle help that person walk again, or are they going to stay plugged in forever and somebody else, you know, it's like being on a dead planet that's being run by technology is what they're looking to do. That's why all the destruction of nature and the resources versus using technology to help restore everything and get us on track. And I mean, it's all related to this. And then, you know, where it stands today, you know, and where I feel it's all led us to is, you know, a mind-controlled, you know, society. We're dealing with not advanced technologies compared to what they have. You know, our phones probably track us wherever we go. We've got smart meters where our skies are being sprayed, and you know, they're creating sort of a synthetic prison cage around us. And so, yeah, be warned. Well, you know, this is part of why I was born into this family, because, you know, I mean, that's the real mission, is to stop this. And certain individuals will allow it. They don't want it to stop. Even ones that you would expect would want it to stop. They love being addicted to the Matrix. They don't want to see anything outside of it. And, you know, at a certain point, it's like there's many other planets, many other worlds. Gaia is multidimensional. You know, after a certain point, I think a lot of us are just going to say, okay, it's time to move on to these higher Earth energies. We'll leave breadcrumbs, you know, of light or footprints, but we're not going to hang around anymore and watch you, you know, destroy yourself and call us crazy and vote these people into office when everything is flashing in your face. And just like you said, why are some people just not able to grasp this and others are? I was born into the Matrix. My mom gave me tap water. I was put in front of the TV. A lot of us were.
Yep.
You know, but some people can't handle it and they turn into absolute zombies.
I'm absolutely addicted to TV. And, you know, you talked about spraying the skies. How do you think a person can tell these days if their bodies have been tampered with? The skies are being sprayed, fluoride in the water, GMOs in the food, everything synthetic. What are we looking at? What kind of assault is really on us today?
Well, the nanoparticles and the chemtrails are getting into, you know, our bodies, and basically the goal is that they will be able to form some kind of antenna in us. And we're going to be like a microchipped, you know, society linked into an artificial intelligence system. And that's basically transhumanism. And I don't quite know perfectly how it all works. But then, you know, other heavy metals, you know, funguses and all sorts of things just to keep us not well, to keep us unable to raise our vibration. And the thing is, we absolutely can raise our vibration even if we're getting sprayed. I mean, we have to watch our belief systems. This is the manipulation as well. If it was just enough to spray us and have ultimate control, they wouldn't bother with false flags. They wouldn't bother with all the media programming and all the different social engineering agendas and all the different people that they prop in front of the teenagers to sort of guide them into a very whacked out way of living and being, very disconnected from maybe what they would, you know, maybe unfold into if they didn't have, you know, those influences. And, you know, if it was just enough to spray us, the rest of the stuff wouldn't exist. So my idea is, as long as you're not programmed, you're going to be able to assimilate and alchemize and transmute all the assaults. But if you buy into the programming, your consciousness is already linked into the low density. Your body is not going to probably be able to handle it, and you are, you know, running a risk of being, you know, very stuck. You know, and it's one thing to watch something and also know that it's kind of fake and false and Matrix stuff. You know, I don't think it's terrible if people watch TV knowing that already. But the ones that just plug right in, believe everything that's told to them, and don't look outside of that, you know, they bought into the programming, and I feel they're the ones that are going to be most affected.
Yeah, I think you're right.
Those that are conscious have already lifted their consciousness above the vibration of chemtrails, And there's, you know, plenty of dimensions to connect with that'll help us to override these low frequencies of what we see.
I you know, chemtrails, it's been one of those last topics that for years I wouldn't touch. I would just kind of steer back. I've kind of kept my arm's length on 9/11. It's like there's a lot to take in here. I don't really buy the official story. All right, let's slowly examine this here. I'm not going to jump out and blurt some stuff, but it's never seemed right. Chemtrails has been like probably the last one that I wouldn't talk about, and just paying more attention. It's just normal air traffic. Look, any day there's going to be planes and they're going to have trails out of them. That is so incorrect. If you just look up into your skies, there will be days they put one in the middle and then two fan out on each on the side and then two more on the other side, and then within a half hour, the entire sky is covered, and you'll see it the next day on the exact opposite side. If you're looking north, it goes south. They are doing something that does not happen every day on a normal pattern. All you have to do is look up. But now, I mean, it's like everybody's looking down under their smartphones. You know, with all this technology, we just kind of seem dumber, and we only talk in 140 characters on Twitter. I want to talk about that as we start wrapping things up here, because when I met you the first time, that was right before 2012. I think we talked about, well, some of the exopolitics, a little bit about Ron Paul, a little bit about the race with Obama and whatnot. And now here we are in 2015, and the window period. Everybody was interested in 2012. There were movies about the world exploding. People were pondering what if in a Y2K kind of scenario. Will Armageddon happen? Are the computers going to turn against us? Is it just going to be anarchy and martial law? What's going to happen in 2012? Nothing. You woke up with a hangover on the next day, and here you were in 2013. So talk about the window period. I know it's something you've been talking a lot about. What have we entered here as far as what we're capable of doing and things we should watch out for?
Well, the window period. A lot of it, you know, has to do with tipping points. It has to do with, you know, what the collective is holding. I mean, anybody who has studied the Hawkins scale, I think that's Hawkins scale, and which is a logarithmic system based on, you know, how people calibrate based on, you know, whatever they're holding. You know, if you're holding love, you calibrate at 500. If you're holding guilt or ignorance, you're calibrating at 200. If you're, you know, holding enlightenment, you calibrate at 1,000. And somebody calibrating above 500, one person can offset millions and millions of people that are, you know, under 500. So one person can offset the negative energy of millions. We have to, you know this. And this window period is a very strong time for even small numbers to create huge impact. You know, sometimes we think it's got to be everybody or it's got to be the masses, but believe me, you know, it could even be one person that just pushes things, you know, in a different direction, depending on their power.
Look what Edward Snowden did. One guy named Edward Snowden, whether he was a psyop implanted there through the government, who knows what the backstory is, or if you were to believe that he's just a good guy. I mean, one guy released all the info to let everyone know through the Fourth Amendment violations, we're all being spied and tracked all the time, blatantly violating our Constitution and Bill of Rights. That was one guy. One guy.
And these are big breakthroughs, you know, and we've had plenty of these sort of breakthroughs. It's just people pick and choose what they want to have their attention on. But this window period is basically a time when the geophysics of the planet is such that the natural stargates are able to open. The planetary body is in alignment with the galactic plane. It's basically healed from being pretty thrown off its axis. You know, a lot of the catastrophes and cataclysms, you know, I mean, the Earth has really been struggling ever since. And being in alignment with the galactic plane gives it, you know, it's kind of like a person, you know, who has been in physical therapy for a really long time after an accident and can finally, like, leave physical therapy and walk and run and play again. And this is sort of where the Earth body is at. Of course, everything under the sun is trying to, you know, keep us from acknowledging this. But when we were a fallen system, that's when the Milky Way galaxy formed. Originally, we were one with the Andromeda galaxy. And so this window period is about being one with the Andromeda galaxy again. And what that means is that we are able to connect with our galactic chakras. We are able to go beyond the seven chakras, which is what the Milky Way system is about. You know, seven archons, seven gates of heaven and hell, and seven pillars of wisdom as Sophia helps us to transform and create alchemy and rise above it. And this is what I pick up on all the time intuitively and what I try and do you know, sometimes it gets, I think people get lost with some of the terminologies. I'm not trying to sound new agey. It's very ancient. It's just, it is what it is. And it's what has been calling, it's always called me, and what I've known and what I've always been connected with. So this is what the window period is about, and what to watch out for is, where you're, what to watch out for is where you, blatantly follow something, or, don't stop and ask a ton of questions, and don't, maybe consider, different viewpoints. It's very important to, step back a lot, get plenty of space and downtime, and exercise the intuition, improve the health, get the physical body, up to par, and, start to, really, look at yourself, what belief systems do you hold that are not allowing you to have ultimate well-being? Because the body is the intelligence. If we're not well, there's something wrong with our belief systems, but we tend to think our belief systems are fine and illness and sickness is just a part of life. If we had the right belief systems and our minds and consciousness were operating, with our bodies in the way it should, we would have optimal health. And that would be a strong indicator that we're really living our truth and that, we have listened to the inner messenger, and people just accept disease, illnesses, medications, and they don't recognize that the body is the most advanced tool to help us wake up and grow. Our life experience does the same thing. The events that we go through, the tragedies, the blessings, in one day we can figure out pretty much everything that we're here to do, or what patterns we need to work on, or what we need to listen to in our bodies, or where our inner voice has not been listened to enough, because of the way our relationships are showing up or the way we're treating ourselves. And literally in a week we can have it all figured out. That's what I attempt to do when I do readings. It's like, let's just map this out. It's not about, worrying about the externals. Let's get a grip on this first, your lifestyle, you, your relationship with yourself, then your other relationships, your children, and then you'll be ready to handle the larger world. And maybe at first you won't, because you might feel sensitive and high vibe, and it's just, we go through all these different stages, but then I'll help them through that phase. And, the thing is, without a vehicle that works, it's like, who's going to get in a plane that doesn't fly very well? It might crash. So how can we expect to drag our bodies around if it's not at its optimal? And another way people, what to watch out for is being constantly drained. And, look at where you haven't recovered from heartache or any wounds of the past. Because if we're fractured, it's very easy for entities to hook onto us. It's very easy for us to, adopt a very negative frame of mind. And, I just say start with the self. Let it branch out to your most immediate, and then it ripple out, let it ripple out to the world. We can't really be of service to the planet if we're not okay. We end up sharing frequencies and energies that we shouldn't be sharing, So give yourself a chance to just kind of hide away and do that extra work. Or find a balance between doing that work and being in service, because we're not going to, we can't wait till we're perfect. But if you say, I'm devoted, I want, my ultimate integrity intact, and I want to grow and prosper, that's enough to engage you in this life experience and to be on the path of health and being a good influence on others. That alone is enough. Because if we, it's not about perfection. If we wait around for perfection, we're going to be miserable. And the path of divinity is not about perfection. It's about simply stepping up and saying, I'm here to participate. If we want our bodies to heal, does our immune system do it for us? Not if we're trashing ourselves. We have to, step up for the rest to reward us. It's a relationship. We have to relate to the earth. We have to be in relationship with spirit. And when we acknowledge it, it's like amazing things happen. If we think that there's no connection, then we go to the matrix for help. And what does that do? It screws us over. It betrays us. It screws with our bank accounts. I mean, it's nothing but just horridness there.
Well, whether it's Mother Earth or your actual mother, I know I went to my mother for a lot of stuff, as we all do, mothers and fathers, when we're fortunate enough to know them and have them in our lives. And said, whether it was talking about, Mom, when did you know you were ready to get married? Or, Mom, when did you know you were ready to have kids? And the comment has come back, and it's, well, Brian, if I would have waited till I was ready, I never would have, because you're never ready. There's no such thing as being ready. You just take a step, and it's a lot like the New American Media. I started this 4 years ago, and you just put one foot in front of the other, and then another foot, and then another foot. And you look back, and it's like, 4 years. I didn't know what I was doing when I started this. I mean, I have a 10-year plan of where I want to take this, obviously. But you just look back, it's like, oh, I did a little bit of something every day, and holy crap, we built something really cool, and we're just warming up. So, I mean, I think you're right about, you can't wait until you're perfect. You can't Because there's no such thing. We're not going to find that in this experience, I really don't think.
No.
It's just doing the best you can with what you have.
You know, just love is, you know, the closest to perfect we can get. And being humble and willing to self-correct, you know. And being in the moment and being conscious in the moment so that we know when we need to do that so that these things don't get buried and, you know, sort of fester underneath the surface, which might end up being something we have to address later on a physical level. And just stay conscious and present, and we can't go wrong. And so what if we have to self-correct? So what if we have to say sorry? So what if we have to rephrase something? But as long as we're conscious and we stay present, and as long as we know when something's attacking us or something's not right for us and we can have a boundary, you know, I think we're, you know, doing great. And I'm very excited about, you know, the future. And I just hope people will get excited and, you know, everything could be really great if we could all just participate and you know, join forces. But, you know, we can't think that if, you know, humanity isn't up for it, that we're going to go down the tubes with them. I mean, whoever has made it to where, you know, you have, that is a good, nobody's going to take that away from you. So don't let what's going on in the world freak you out. You're not going to be taken down by those who choose to stay ignorant. You've got your own timeline, you've got your own vibration and agreements, and, you know, enslavement is a bit of an illusion. Most of these people are fine being enslaved. The ones that aren't, you don't have to worry. You know, you're not. You're free already. Embrace it.
Yeah, it really is a situation where there are some awake people, there are some people that are definitely asleep at the switch, and all you can do is trust your gut. You just got to trust your intuition, and if you know something's wrong, if you smell a rat, if you think the fix is in, you know, you can only allow, you know, if you've seen those Saw horror movies, that's basically what ISIS is releasing on a weekly basis these days, you know, and it's all meant to really just destroy that part of our soul that gives a damn. It's just meant to wear us down with the brutality and the disgustingness of what humans can be, and it's like, at some point, there's only so much of that you can consume, and there's only so much of your time and mental energy that you can put forth on those topics, because you're not in charge of them. You're not on the battlefield if you're not there. If you're not directly impacting policy, there's only so much you can do. And you referenced it a little earlier ago, and you said you got to look in the mirror. You got to start with yourself. That's where the change become the change that you want to see in the world. Start with yourself and just try to do something better today than you did yesterday. Set a goal for tomorrow and try to clean up an area of your life that, you know, has been disheveled or not treating you so well. And yeah, in those ways, that frees you up to then take on little bits and pieces of different agendas and trying to make an impact in your local community, in your family, in your personal decisions that you're making on a daily basis. That's really what we have control over, is taking care of ourselves. And we have just about run out of time here, Laura. And speaking of taking care of ourselves, I want to make sure that we take care of you again. And in the last minute or two here, I want you to just kind of remind people where they can find you online, where they can get connected with you, what you're up to, if you got any speaking engagements coming up. I know we just did the Conscious Life Expo a month or so ago. But yeah, I just want to make sure everybody knows how to stay connected with you until you and I do another radio show sometime, hopefully soon.
Excellent. My website is cosmicgaiasophia.com. There you can find everything about my events, the services I do, as far as readings. You can find me on Facebook. I've loved being on the show. It's just been amazing to chat with you, and I just, you know, really encourage people to, you know what your patterning is, know, you know, what you came in with, you know what your gifts are, know what you need to work on, because sometimes it can take 20 years or so to figure it out when we can find out in just one day, and I'd love to help. So thanks again, and that's CosmicGaiaSophia.com.
Excellent. Laura, I appreciate your time. Like I said, between 2012 and just now, hopefully we won't wait 3 years to reconnect again, but I'm glad we did. I think just peeling back the layers of this onion are beyond fascinating. It's something that I'm actually really curious to see what the sports fans that tune in for my sports radio show, the people that are just totally into the politics, like I do a lot of political shows, I'm really curious to see the feedback that they're going to have now that we've had a good opportunity to really hash out some of these topics, and kind of get that conversation going, because the minutiae, the daily nonsense we all have to put up with, it's only so important. It really comes down to who are we, how did we get here, what's the point, and what happens when we leave. And, you know, when we start digging into the soul and past lives and exopolitics, it really starts connecting the dots in a way that a lot of the dogma that's been pushed on us, it really has left me hollow and seeking answers. And I think there's a lot of people out there that that's resonating with as well, especially in 2015 when people have been woken up because they shot themselves in their foot on 9/11. I really like how you phrased that. So, Laura, hey, you have a great weekend. We will be talking again soon. And as long as it's okay with you, my buddy John B. Wells, who used to be on Coast to Coast AM, now he's doing Caravan to Midnight. He was a guest a couple weeks ago. We've had a talk so many times about getting you onto his program. So if it's okay, I want to connect you two off air, because I think you guys are going to have an amazing conversation, and I want to hear that one as well.
Oh, excellent. Thank you so much. I would love that.
All right. Well, hey, Laura, have a great weekend. We'll talk again soon. I certainly appreciate it. And for everybody out there, please make sure you check out our homepage, thenewamericanmedia.com. Go on the right-hand side. There's a TNAM radio link. That's where you click play to listen live. Make sure that you're doing that. You can sign up on Twitter. We're at American_media_. Click on our Facebook link. You can subscribe, youtube.com/thenewamericanmedia. I appreciate you. I love you. And until next time, peace.
Your guide to the truth, thenewamericanmedia.com.
Hi, everybody. You're listening to Agree to Disagree with Brian Engelman, and this is John B. Wells reminding you that not only is Brian Engelman a cool guy, and not only is thenewamericanmedia.com a very cool platform, but here's a cool idea for you, too. Are you alone? Not really. Do you like dogs? Do you like cats? You do. Of course you do. Everybody does. One or the other, maybe even both. You know, there are a lot of dogs and cats that are at shelters right now, and if somebody doesn't take them home, they're going to wind up euthanized. That's a nice way of saying they're going to be killed, because there's simply not enough room. I guarantee it, the best dogs and the best cats, the best pets, come from shelters. There's something about dogs and cats. They know. They know where they are. You walk through one of them, and certainly at least one is going to look at you and go, I wish you'd take me home. I'm in hell. Please take me out of here. It'll be the best thing that you ever did for your soul. You'll feel good about it. And not only that, but you have a friend for life. Doesn't matter if you got money, you don't have money. Well, it doesn't make any difference to a dog or cat. All they need is the sound of your voice and maybe even the stroke of your hand, and they're fine. Maybe a little food every once in a while. The sweetest sound that those pets ever hear is your voice. Think it over and adopt a cat or a dog from a local shelter today. I'm telling you, you'll be glad you did.